York I got him, real New York on him, and then I like put up my bows, my elbows up in his face, saying that to him. And then after I said aho, which means idiot in Japanese, mm-hmm. he spat at me. We are girly and girlified, and we're talking to you. Hey, this is Kurly and Kansai, a podcast about us two curly-headed ladies living in the Kansai area of
Japan.
There is no other language to say Japan today because we did not remember to look up another way of saying Japan.
Yeah, who cares? It's the end of the year.
Oh my God.
Whatever.
It's the end. It's the last episode this year?
Yeah, this is the last episode for the year. I'm Ayana.
I'm Alyse.
And this is episode 39. And it's, like I said, the last episode for 2018, because we're not going to do another one, like, right before New Year's.
No, it's already, like, basically the end of the month.
Right.
So
we have things to do.
Lives to lead.
Lives to lead, to live. And
movies to watch.
People to see? No?
No. Just movies.
We're just going to relax a bit, take a break. Yeah. We do take breaks. We take usually summer break. It's usually a month.
That's because you be out.
That too. And just we take breaks because...
You need breaks.
We need it.
It's healthy.
It is healthy for all of us. The watchers and the people doing the show. Us.
Now that we've discussed our mental state of health.
Yes. Let's talk about our weekend. Our weekend. What did we do? Weekend?
Oh, yeah. I already, like, put it in the back of my memory banks. We went to Tokyo.
Yay!
We weren't even there for the weekend, though. It was, like, part of the weekend.
Well, I say weekend because my life has no weeks anymore.
Look at you. Every day is a weekend for me.
Well, not always. I mean, I work, like, 3 days a week now. Oh. For those who don't know, I don't have a full-time job anymore, so...
She's self-employed.
Freelance. but yeah, so we went to Tokyo last week on Thursday, and we went to where?
Disney Sea.
And that was quite an adventure.
It was. We had a good time.
Yes, I did have a good time. We went with a few other ladies that we know in Tokyo that live
Black
there.
Black Girl Magic.
Black Girl Magic. And if you haven't seen our Instagram stories and posts, then you need to get on that and see the fun that we had and also the meme that I made of myself.
Yes, it was a memeable moment. Hopefully it catches on.
To be honest, because we talked about amusement parks already.
Yes, we did.
And I already shared my feelings about Japanese amusement parks. And it's like, I only went to USJ, so I was like, all right, I'll give it another chance.
Right.
Went to Disney Sea. And if I had to rate it out of 5 stars, I'd give it a 2.
Ooh. Ooh. That's low. Why a 2? Why not a 3 or 4? What was it that was not bringing
Again,
you the moment?
Lack of thrillful rides. Mm. I need roller coasters in my life to make it a 3.
Yes.
It got 2 because it was just fun to be around. Like, probably the 1 star was because I was with my friends.
Had nothing to do with the park.
2 was because it was a well-built and planned park. Like, it's pretty.
Very well
it's
designed.
So pretty. I like seeing it. We took a lot of pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And it was cute. That's about it. I wouldn't give it a 3. Sorry.
Ooh, Disney do better. Well, Disney Japan. Tokyo Disney Sea.
Yeah, Tokyo Disney
Sea. Not owned by the people that own the parks in America. So
yeah, we
different.
Realized that. And then I think what maybe didn't give it a 3 also is that show, that Christmas show that I saw. That's where the meme comes from. If you look at my Instagram, I made a face. But to be fair for Disney, I was hungry, had a headache, and it was cold. And then the performance just did not help. So I just was like, given a really nasty look. And somehow Elise just got that. Yes, that snap
that
at the right moment.
Shot of the day.
And then I told everybody on my Instagram to make, like, caption it. And then also on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And Ramanda B on YouTube as well. She's the one that won. So, yeah, please check that out.
Those ain't got no hilarious. Time for this Mickey shit.
Yeah, this Mickey Mouse shit. Shit was hilarious. But, yeah, that was our weekend/last week.
Yes.
Thing. And then we also did a podcast episode with Raw Urban Mobile Podcasts.
Rump.
Rump is the short version of that name. with Tokyo Cliff. Mm-hmm. He's another black podcaster in Japan. And then we also was with Mega from the Mega Late Show, another mm-hmm. podcaster, black podcaster in Japan. So it was a really fun collab to do. And when that comes out, we will share. And you can check out what we have to say on that.
Does this date their episode?
Not really. Okay. Yeah, because okay. we recorded it, but it's for like a future episode. So we could talk about it whenever. Oh, okay. But like when we were doing the episode, we couldn't say like, yeah, Christmas is coming. Like we couldn't date it even because it's coming later.
Okay.
But yeah, so we'll share that when it comes.
Yay. Look forward.
Yeah. Now for last week's episode, we talked about, what did we talk about?
Not
we
had last
Mai.
Week,
yeah.
2 weeks ago.
I said last week. I meant last episode. Whatever. We were talking about what? Alcoholism or just the drinking culture in Japan.
Yes.
And we had Mai as our guest. And we're going to sorry, I can't speak. We're going to look at some of the comments. So first comment was on YouTube by Inner Moonchild. Yay. I like Inner Moonchild. Do you know her? Mm-hmm. Okay. She said, they still sell alcohol in the seating area at football stadiums. Don't recall baseball. So this is about the U.S. In the U.S., they definitely advertise alcohol commercials during sports game. Zero calorie drinks are now the thing since everyone is on some kind of diet and keto is currently in too.
Oh, yeah. Zero calorie drinks are big here too. Or low calorie drinks. Very big here.
Clearly. I didn't really realize that. And the keto thing, that I mean, that's not about drinking. Mm-hmm. I heard about that a little bit earlier before it became a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah.
I do wonder, though, does America have non-alcoholic beverages? Because that's a thing in Japan. For people that have to drive, but they want to drink beer, they can drink a non-alcoholic beer or a non-alcoholic, like, cocktail. So they can get the sensation of drinking without actually getting drunk. And I wonder if that's a thing in America. Like, would you?
I don't think it would be a thing like it is here, because the culture is so alcohol based. Like, you have to go out drinking with your coworkers.
Yeah.
So it's like, all right, I'll have this. I'll taste the flavor of beer, but I won't have the alcohol.
Right. But I'm like, why don't you just get something else to drink?
Right, that's what I'm thinking. But there's going to be some people who just love the taste of beer.
Oh, beer.
Which there are some people who do, but just don't want to get drunk.
Do they? Do people that like the taste of beer not want to get? I feel like if you're drinking beer, you want to get drunk, right?
I don't know.
It's straight. I think
all I know is that non-alcoholic beers don't taste the same.
No, so they don't. So it's not even the same taste in the end.
Not going to want to drink it.
Yeah, I'm just curious. If anybody in other countries has any information, please let us know.
Yeah.
Because I'm interested. I wonder if Japan is the only one with alcoholic-free beer.
Yeah, I don't know.
Alcohol-free beer.
The next comment is by Terrestrial from Instagram. And he said the term that we were trying to figure out about osake suyoi.
Mm-hmm.
In English, the equivalent would be I can handle my drinks.
Mm-hmm.
But again, when we were talking about it on the episode, I was thinking like, yeah, we don't really say it like we're proud.
No, no one's like, oh yeah, I'm a heavy drinker.
Like,
yeah.
That's not a thing you want to
go around flaunting.
Or like we talk about, we can drink someone under the table. Or like, I don't know. We don't say it like how Japanese say it.
I feel like that's still a more dated thing. Like, we don't say it now.
We don't.
Maybe like in a movie from like the 1950s or 60s, maybe somebody's saying that. But now, being an alcoholic, I hope, is not in fashion.
I hope not either.
I hope.
All right. Just being addicted to anything should not be.
In fashion.
In fashion. Should not be a trend.
Yes.
The next person that commented, I can't speak right now. I don't know what it is today, but like when Alyse came in, she was just making all these noises. And I'm just like, wait, what? You're being weirder than me. And I guess now I caught whatever you
it's
got.
It's just you.
It's just me. Anyway, Helen, she commented again, and was such a good comment, I had to, like, shout her out again, so shout out to Helen. Helen said, I have such a crush on your guest, Mai. We need more people like that, especially in Japan. It's wild to go through Shibuya and see people casually pass out. I definitely agree with that health issues are not discussed and functioning addict is an actual thing. But as you mentioned, if you still go to work and make bread, do you really have a problem? I guess furthermore, people in this country are so lucky that their culture gives back things like the salary man passed out with $1,000 Rolex on his wrist and his iPhone X just chilling by his side. Nobody stole anything. So in Japan, alcohol is just a way to cope with the side effects of capitalism. Granted, this exists in any other capitalist country, but in Japan, it's just like up so high. Mm-hmm. It's like capitalism plus their Japanese culture.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what they have to cope. And Helen goes on to say, I can only imagine how it is to live in a household with someone who doesn't even recognize they have a problem. So yeah, Japan. Capitalism, Japanese culture, alcohol.
It's a dangerous combination.
Right, right. Well, that was the comments for last episode. Did you have anything else to add?
I did, but I forgot.
Oh, no.
Next time we'll do it.
All right. So this episode, we're going to talk about some new policies that are going to set up in Japan very soon. It's the new foreign worker policy or bill.
Yes, they're creating a new visa for what they call unskilled laborers.
Which I hate that term because they're skilled as fuck.
Some of them, especially from a lot of developing countries, actually don't have any skills, which is what the old program was for, to give them skills like construction or farming. And that's what the old unskilled like labor, I guess, visa was for. You bring them in, you teach them how to do something, and then they're supposed to go back after 3 years and teach people in their home country how to do these things.
All right, so I'm coming from the view of America in like when they call farmers unskilled workers.
That's just, most of that is illegal immigrants, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Different, America has a very different problem. Not even a problem. They just have a different system that is very, I don't know, America's a mess. But in Japan, they tried to create a system. A lot of Japanese companies abused it. They didn't pay people. They had them in terrible living conditions. A lot of people ran away from their employers, and they're like shelters for laborers that had to run away from abusive employers. Overall, the system I hear is not very successful.
Right.
For this training program. They call it a training intern something visa.
Right. Because like they will hold, like some people would get their visas or their passport held.
Yeah. So they can't leave.
They can't
like
leave.
It's a hostage situation in some of the worst cases. I've seen a few Japanese TV shows about it.
Really?
They do talk about it like once a year, you know, just to show we're diverse. We care about other people's problems, I guess. But yeah, it's pretty.
Well, also with that sense, I guess like with the farmers, because I've read an incident about that and about the guy who's saying I'm overworked. They're mean to me and they have my passport and I'm trying to run out. I'm trying to like run away. And then I think it was last year, there was this lady who came from some country in Africa to be a housekeeper, I guess. And then she was having some issues with that guy and he also was like keeping her passport. And some people thought the story was a little fishy. I don't really know for sure, but we tried our best to help her because this was in the Facebook group that we were in with the black women. So it's like, okay, let's try to figure this out and like see how you can get out of it. But like for each foreigner, depending on what country you're from, like your embassy is going to, you know, deal with things differently. Because like I only can come from an American mindset and what my embassy can do for me. So it's like, for me, I'm like, oh, I can get out of this shit. But like, I don't know what your country can do to help you in Japan if you're in trouble. So.
Right. Maybe they don't even have like a consulate. Maybe they got to go to Tokyo. A lot of countries have a consulate in Tokyo, which means you have to go to Tokyo. And if you ain't got no money and your stuff's being held hostage.
It's like, you really got to figure out where your thing is first before you move here. Like,
yeah. Have a backup plan for sure, but I feel like when you're coming from a desperate situation, like maybe some of these people are, they're just trying to get a little bit of money, right?
Right. So
it's sad.
Well, I was curious about like when Japan started this. You said when? Did you say the year when they started? Okay, mm-hmm. So when we were looking at the articles, it says Japan has received unskilled foreign workers since 1993, mm-hmm. but only as trainees, like you said, who are required to stay with one employer and are typically allowed to stay for only 3 years. Blue-collar workers who have mastered the required skill. What did you write? You wrote that there, right?
Oh, yeah, that's what I wrote. Because I'm like, how does one judge that someone has mastered a skill? Like, right. Mastering a skill usually takes years.
Usually, like, 10 years.
Right. So, yeah. I'm like, that means they have to work in a foreign country for 10 years before they can even, like, bring their families? Like, who wants to do that?
Yeah, and, like, this new bill is saying 5 years, right?
Yeah. Oh, is it 5 years?
3 to 5?
Before they can bring their families?
I don't know about bringing their families. I think it's like you have to go back home.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Not bringing their families. Because
I think bringing their families still is like a long time.
Yeah.
Which is ridiculous because that's not good for anyone's mental health to make them, you know, be away from their family. Forced.
I think it's because they're used to sending their Japanese people out abroad for like some odd years. Because I right now currently teach part-time mm-hmm. at this place where the students in from a company will come for 1 week.
Okay.
And then after that, they go off abroad for how many years their company is sending them. And the students that I had this week mm-hmm. was like, oh, I'm going to be gone for 3 years. My baby was just born.
Oh, wow.
I was like, what? You can't bring your family? No.
Wow.
Yeah, so some of them get lucky where they're like, I can bring my family, but right. a lot of them don't.
That's so sad.
So I think because they come with that mindset and they do it to their own people already, mm-hmm. that they don't mind doing it to foreigners.
That's that Japanese culture, right?
Mm.
That is protected because reasons, I guess.
Whatever. So yeah, I don't really like that idea. Because at first when I heard about this new visa, I was like, oh, does this apply to everybody? But the more I read about it, I realized it was for this unskilled program.
Yes.
So they have two types, though. They have two types of visas. The one is for people who can only stay for a certain amount of years. Mm-hmm. And then the other one is where you can actually get permanent residency.
Right. One has a road to permanent residency.
Yes.
A road. You're not guaranteed it.
Mm.
You might, maybe, could maybe, possibly get it one day.
Right. And, like, these articles say that the government is going to be checking these companies to make sure that their foreign workers are being treated, you know, fairly.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm like, really? How closely are you guys going to be checking? Because you've had this issue before. And
right.
I feel like in the beginning you're like, yeah, I'm gonna go gung-ho and check in, like, we're gonna get all these new workers and it's gonna be a booming economy now. And then like another year later they're like, oh, this
yeah, because they have like
work.
Before you can go and start making these support groups, you gotta train a group of Japanese people that know Japanese law that can also speak more than one language.
Right. And they don't. Like, they already have problems with just the random, not random, but, like, going to immigration.
Yeah.
They don't even speak another language for, you know, people from different countries.
Yeah, they'd be hella rude, even if they do.
They're so sometimes. Rude. They, like, it's like, okay, great. Like, English is a privileged language, so usually people would have English first, right?
Mm-hmm.
But they don't even speak English at the immigration office. So it's like, I don't know how they'll even provide for people from, like, China, Korea.
Well, in Osaka they do, but you have to make an appointment.
Oh, okay. Well, there's
and
that.
She's not nice. I got into an argument with her.
Well, I
that
haven't.
Was years ago.
Oh, okay. Years
ago. She might not even be there anymore. But it was just the one lady, and they okay. were like, you have to, no, you have, yeah, you have to, like, make an appointment, but we're like, we have to do this today. So we just had to wait, like, I think an hour and some change for her to just be available, I guess. I don't know, she's probably helping somebody. I don't know. But she was attitude-y.
Yeah.
And the whole immigration system is, like, really...
I was just like, with everything with the bureaucracy and red tape in Japan, I feel like they're not ready for the influx of foreigners in different languages.
No.
Like in America, like we started off with very different languages and cultures here. So it was able to adapt a little bit easier. But here it's like they've always been like, Japan, Japan first, Japan
right.
this, you've got to learn Japanese. But yet they don't speak to us in Japanese.
No.
It's like, how are you going to help us if none of your websites are multi-language?
Mm-hmm.
And then when we get to you to ask you personally, you don't know how to talk to us. Because, like,
yeah.
let's say we speak Japanese. They don't know how to talk to us correctly.
Yeah. Some of them, like, some people that know, like, okay, this is not your native language, they'll try to break stuff down. Some other people, they'll just repeat the same thing over and over again.
They don't even reword it. They just, like, every time I say, you need to understand it. I mean, just recently happened to me. So it's like,
right.
oh, okay.
Like, if they say it enough times, it'll just click in your mind. And you're like, oh, yeah, now I know what that word means because
right.
you've repeated it 10 times.
So,
but.
the article say for the fiscal year in mm-hmm. April 2019 alone, experts are to accept about... Experts. That's not the word that's written here. They are to expect to accept about 33,000 to 47,000 foreign workers for an estimate shortage of more than 600,000 laborers, is what it says. So it's still not really fulfilling what they need, but it's a help. But I don't know if it's really a help when you're going to have a lot of frustrated people and miscommunication. And
That's a lot of what the opposition party of the government was saying, because they kind of brought this bill up in like the last half of this year. I don't recall hearing about
I didn't hear about earlier. It until recently.
Yeah, like in the last few months. They were like, oh, I guess we need to change up immigration rules. And so a lot of people are like, well, hold up. Well, like, do we have a system in place to support an influx
they don't do that.
Immigrants? And do we have, because one thing they were showing on, actually, I think it was on NHK, they were talking about this family that came from Brazil, so they don't speak English, they speak Portuguese, Brazilian, or Brazilian Portuguese, what is it?
Portuguese, Brazilian. And
he was actually, his grandfather or something was Japanese, so that's how he got his visa. He's the descendant of a Japanese citizen, so he gets his visa through that, and then he can bring his family. But his son was like, I think, 9 years old, born and raised in Brazil, so all he speaks is Brazilian Portuguese.
Right.
But he has to come because his dad is moving. And I felt so bad for the kid because it's really hard just jumping into Japanese education, especially from third, I think it's the third grade when you're nine, because they start from a really young age learning Japanese, hiragana, katakana, and then from first grade they learn kanji. That's 7 years old. They 6 years old. They start learning kanji because they got a few thousand characters to memorize. So this nine-year-old kid is coming and he has to start from 9 years old, and he's thrown into a class where they've already memorized probably like 500 to 600 kanji. They probably know more anyway just from interacting with it daily.
Right.
And he's like, I'm lonely all the time, and no one wants to talk to me because I can't communicate, and I want to go back to Brazil. And I just felt so bad. And like, how many kids are going to be forced into these situations where the schools can't really provide the education because now the school's scrambling to get teachers to teach him basic Japanese, but he's smart. He's not dumb.
Right.
He's like, I get the like science stuff and I get the math stuff. I just can't answer because I don't speak Japanese.
Right.
And I'm like, that's so sad. And I'm like, why don't they just send him to an international school? But of course,
too expensive.
Right. No one can afford that. And I'm like, you guys really need to get a better system because you could stunt him. Like he's smart. He just can't speak the language, and now he's.
I mean, the only way for him to combat that is if his parents provide extra learning things at home.
Right.
Did your school, like growing up in DC, not DC, Maryland, did they have like programs for international students?
They had English as a second language classes. So when we took English, they had the ESL course.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we had that. But I just feel like Japan doesn't provide that for any of
their They definitely form. Should have a Japanese as a second. It was weird the way they had the classroom set up because they had a teacher for each student.
Yeah.
But I'm like, why aren't they just learning the language together? Doesn't make sense for like one on one. It was weird. I'm like, they definitely need to take a note from like other countries with, you know, the national language as a second language kind of courses.
Right, right.
I'm sure they don't have any research any experience.
They have more. Really gotta go abroad. They have more like stuff for English education than they do for Japanese education for a second language.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
But even their governmental based English learning is crap.
It's very dated. The system is also inefficient, and most people don't end up speaking the language very well after attending school.
Yeah, it's more so for the test anyway. It's not for speaking. What was this? The next quote that I saw in one of the articles from The Guardian, the current edition of the right-wing magazine, Sapio, features a series of articles warning of a rise in violence, sex crimes, and cultural clashes, while the private broadcaster Fuji TV was criticized for a recent program about visa overstayers that demonized immigrants.
They do that on cop TV shows a lot.
Oh my God.
They'll be chasing them through rice fields. This guy overstayed his visa. And it's like, well, he's just working. Or they'll choose like illegal immigrants that are also doing illegal shit. So it's like, look, they're bad and they're ruining our country. And it's like, oh.
I think half the time people overstay their visa is because they don't want to go back to their shitty country or like because something's wrong or they just can't afford to go back home a lot of times.
Right. It's not very cheap flying. It can be cheap depending on where you're going, but It's not the cheapest.
No,
it's still not the cheapest. If I didn't have the job that I had now, I wouldn't be able to travel, probably.
So, like, you do watch, like, Japanese TV. Is there more about what Japanese feel or on the shows that they
say about? Of course not, because no one is trying to have their real feelings out there in Japan. Everyone is very, like, in the middle. No one's for or against it. No one's saying anything they're polarized.
Centrist. Oh, yeah, my God.
Like, they're like, oh, yes, well, we do have a population problem, but I don't know if adding more immigrants is the answer, but we should find an answer, and then that's the end of the conversation. So no one's really... I feel like no one really wants to think about a solution because either they're afraid of immigrants or they just don't think the government, they don't trust the government to deal with it properly, which I could sympathize with. The government is inefficient in many ways. Yeah, on TV, I think they're ignoring it now. It's been on the news. The parliament arguments are hilarious.
Yeah.
Because people are like, the guys are yelling at Abe. They're like, "Nanyutendaro! Chanto kotaero!" Like, it's a mess in parliament right now. They're just yelling at Abe because he doesn't give them answers, right? It was in the articles.
Oh, wow.
They ask Abe, like, oh, how are you going to, like, cover this? Do you have the numbers of how many people you want to bring in? And Abe the whole time is like, oh, we're going to figure that out later. We're going to give you those answers later. So everyone was getting, they were getting uppity. They had security come in. But in the end, they just forced the law through. Because Abe has the majority, if you guys didn't know, he has the majority party.
Okay.
He controls, I think there's like two houses or something. So in the end, he could just force it through because he has the numbers.
So if there's something that he really wants, he'll just force it through.
That's the dangerous thing about the Abe administration. They basically have total control and they can do whatever they want, which, depending on the policies they push through, could be not good. But he's friends with Trump, so it's fine, right? It's fine. He loves Trump. Trump loves him.
Okay.
Like, I don't know. This is, like, getting worse and worse. Basically, it's pretty similar to the situation in the UK where they kind of adjusted the immigration policies, had an influx of migrant workers or immigration. A lot of people immigrated to the country. And it kind of had a negative effect on public opinion towards immigrants and immigrant workers. And sort of led into what kind of caused Brexit.
Yeah.
A lot of the same makings can be seen in the Japanese policy where it's kind of hasty, not very well thought through, and could end up, especially if the negative publicity keeps going where, like you said earlier in that quote about high crime rates.
Right.
That it's not really... There's, of course, more Japanese people still commit crimes, but... The way that the news could frame it could make it sound like immigrants are going to raise the rate of crimes, and it could.
It's just unfortunate because it's like when you have immigrants coming in, a lot of times they're just trying to find a better place to live. Mm-hmm. We're not trying to come in and make crime.
Right.
And it reminds me of when, like, the people running away from bad things trying to get into the States.
Mm-hmm.
They're running away from violence.
Yeah.
They're not trying to cause violence.
Yeah.
And then I think for people in Japan, they're trying to get a job. They're not trying to cause trouble.
Right.
So.
Because that would not help them in any way.
Not at all. Nobody wants to get arrested and then get deported.
Yeah.
That doesn't make any sense.
Not at all.
And oh my God. Loss of words again. So yeah, I feel like with this policy and then the 2020 Olympics coming soon,
mm-hmm.
that there's a rise in like, attacks or not, maybe not attacks, but like xenophobic
incidents
is the word, or just people thinking the worst of foreigners.
Yeah, I would say unprovoked encounters.
Yes,
maybe on the rise.
Right.
I've noticed some hostility, and I've been here for like 8 years. So when I get this like hostility on the train, they look at me like, "Oh my God, you're taking up space on the train." I'm like, "Motherfucker, I ride this train more often than you do, though." Because I got to go to work. I don't see you on this train. I'm on the same train, this car, every day, the same time where you've been. Like, it's frustrating because I'm just trying to get to work.
Right. We're just trying to make a living and live. Minding our own business.
Yeah.
So with that, I had asked on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter if anybody that I know just people that I would know have these encounters with Japanese, like, unprovoked, mind your own business, and then Japanese person that comes at you, yelling at you, or, like, hit you. Mm-hmm. And there was quite a few people. There was more than 20. that I could, because I asked today. It's like, I think if I had left it for a while, there would probably be more than that. But yeah, it was just quite, unsurprising for me. Shocking for some people, like on my Facebook who don't live here. And they're like, oh, this happens in Japan? It's like, I thought it was a utopia here. No.
There's no such thing. Don't.
There's no such thing as a utopia in this
world. I think it's the rates of those kinds of incidents are higher in bigger cities, though, because tensions are just higher in bigger cities. It's crowded. Everybody's tired. Everybody wants their space, and they can't get it.
Right. So I said in the past couple of years, my incident with the old man wasn't in the last couple of years. It was like a few years, so like 3 years ago for sure.
The bicycle thing.
I don't think it was.
I thought it was last year.
Was it last year?
It was pretty recent.
No, you're right, because I was here. I was living here.
You had just moved here and you tried biking.
And I was trying to bike to
Umeda. And I told you not to do it. I told her not to do
okay,
it.
Okay, yeah, it was the past 2 years then, yeah. Well, let me just, I don't know if I said it fully on this podcast, but the story was I was riding my bicycle and I was trying to find a place to park before I met up with my friend in Umeda. So I was like, oh, I don't live that far from Umeda. So I was like, let me bike. And I'm trying to, you know, get some exercise in, save money. So when I was trying to find the parking spot, I stopped my bike like a little bit in the way of, I guess, pedestrians on the sidewalk, but it was like my bike was mostly set to the side. It was just the front wheel that was kind of sticking out. But again, there was space for people to move.
The sidewalks are pretty big.
They're pretty big. They're pretty wide. So I'm here on the phone trying to find the place to park it because someone was telling me like, oh, you can park it around here. And then this old man, like grumpily, he's just like, was like, move your bike, like in Japanese, of course. And I'm looking at him and I'm just like on my phone and he's still like grumpily saying everything to me while he's walking past me. And I'm getting like a little heated because like I move my bike after he said it because I'm like, oh shit, I'm in the way. Even though I'm looking, I'm like, he's not even moving. He's like completely away from the bike. He can pass through with no problem. I said, shitsureina, like that was rude. But I didn't say it too loud, but I said it loud enough for him to hear. He comes back and then it's like, I don't remember everything he said, but like basically he's berating me. And then that's when things kind of get heated because I'm just like, leave me alone. And I'm like cussing him out in English. Of course he doesn't understand it, but I'm getting more aggressive because I'm like, leave me alone. Like he's getting in my face. Mind you, he's like 5'2".
Trying to get in your face.
Trying to get in my face. And then at some point when I'm, because I'm shouting now, I'm like really, really angry. And there's people around looking and there's roadside assistance people that are actually crossing the street to come and help. Thank you to them though. So basically I'm shouting and he's getting in my face. And then I said, aho to him. Because he's like, he clearly doesn't understand what I'm saying. Fuck you, bitch, in his face.
You got him straight up New York
on him, probably. I got real New York on him. And then I, like, put up my bows, my elbows up in his face, saying that to him. And then after I said, aho, which means idiot in Japanese, he spat at me. He didn't really land it, but I felt little bits of it, like, trying all around my face.
Gross.
Then that's when I, like, kind of, like, push him a little bit more. But I'm not actually aggressively pushing. I'm just putting up my elbows and, like, getting in his face, and he's stepping backwards. And then this other guy, I don't know if he knew him or if he was walking by and sees it, he starts taking video. So once I notice that he's taking video, I stop. I drop my elbows. I stop, and I go after that guy. And that guy's face, who's recording, he was like, oh, shit, like slow motion. And then he turns around and tries to run away. And me, I was a former trackie. I used to run.
Not getting away from me.
He was not getting away from me. And, like, this idiot, like, walks into a wall. Like, he was, like, stuck. And then the roadside assistance people also help me. They catch him because he goes into the wall. And they stop him. And he's, like, nervous. But, like, he's trying to be intimidating to me, too. But, like, no, I said, delete that. Delete that. I kept saying, cash day. And the roadside assistance people were like, what? Delete what? It's like, he took a video of me. And they're like, please delete it. Because in Japanese law, it's illegal to take video of someone without their permission. And clearly, I don't want him taking it.
Right.
And I also just, my mindset then was like, oh, he's taking video. I don't want this on online, because I'm clearly not at the right state to be like put online. Like, I don't want that online.
That would definitely put foreigners in a bad light, because he could just frame it however he could cut it up, right, and show whatever parts he wants
exactly to create a narrative. And we already know how the world thinks of dark skinned people, so I just like, I don't want to be on the internet. I watched him delete it, and then after that, I got my bike and I walked away. And the people who were helping me were like, "Oh, Nason, please wait, please wait." And I'm like, "No." And I just got on my bike and I rode away while they were trying to catch me and hold the bike. I'm like, I'm not waiting for the police, because they're going to waste my time. And either I'm going to be the one that's in trouble and I have to just say sorry, or like, I'm just wasting my time and I'm missing the time to meet my friend. So that was my incident, and that was last year. In the summer, I think it was warm. And I was just very angry, and I'm like, I don't know what to do here anymore. Why am I still in Japan? But it's really not as big as a deal as I think it is with other people when they deal with shit with Japanese. But I just felt like, why is he attacked? He basically unprovoked attacked me verbally first.
Yeah, I mean, that's like old men in Japan, though. They just yell at people. And give them a reason to, like, get started, and they're not going to shut the hell up. I only have one small minor encounter when I was trying to get off the train. You know how people stand out of the ways of the doors? So I'm trying to get off the train, and this old dude just pushed me. I wasn't really in it. I was walking around him, but he pushed me anyway. And I was like, don't push me. And then he started trying to get an attitude. And he was like, who are you talking to? And I'm just like, all right, I'm leaving. But I was like, what is going on? Why are we so violent?
I don't know.
Why are we so angry? Why? I need to get out of a city. I can't live here.
Yeah, it's a lot of it has to do with the city and the crowdedness, I guess, but also just people in general are just mean. I feel like Osaka is a little bit warmer than Tokyo, but it's still a city and there's still jackass people around.
That's never happened to me in DC.
Right?
I've never been pushed by anybody or yelled at by anybody. Well, trying to get on.
As long as you're not in New York City. New York City, you'll be all
New York, I hear the trains are a little bit crazy.
No, the trains are crazy. That's a fact.
But DC, the trains are very polite. Everybody's very orderly.
Right. Like other incidents well, you weren't around. You weren't really around, but in our showcase, we mentioned before, our event that was in May, we had this guy call the cops on us like 7 times because of a noise complaint. But the owner of our place is a foreigner. He's a black foreigner. He says that owner doesn't like us. He's across the street. He just doesn't like him. So he just had an excuse, noise complaint. But then at the very end of the event, he comes out again and just starts yelling at the leftover customers there and calls one girl the N-word. And it was just like, that was unnecessary. Like, why are you so angry? And how do you know how to use that word? It's like a lot of times I feel like Japanese people who know that word and just use it don't really know the extent of that word, but know that it hurts us.
They know they shouldn't be saying it.
They know they shouldn't be saying it. They probably watch some TV show and realize, like, oh, if I say this, this will upset them.
They probably on the internet, definitely, because there's a lot of crazy nationalist people on Japanese internet. And I'm sure they got an arsenal, like, when you see this kind of foreigner, you should say this. When you see this kind of foreigner, you should say this. And it'll make them angry. They don't like it. I'm just like, man, y'all need it.
Yeah, it's a lot. So, like, I'm just going to summarize what I got from people. So there was a girl in the Black Women in Japan group who talked about her just staying in a cafe and this old lady coming and attacking her and, like, pushing her stuff and breaking stuff. There was my friend who, even yesterday, was randomly attacked by this old man, just shouting at him, not really sure why, because he had his headphones on. And then when the guy was in his face, he kind of pushed him away, like, please get out of my face. The Japanese guy's like, Keisatsu! Just calling the police. And then another one was this lady who was riding her bike slowly, kind of nicked someone's her side view mirror. And the guy came out of the car because it was like stopped at a light and like stopped her from going further and called the police on her. And then she got like manhandled a bit. And she's in her 60s.
Oh, wow.
Yes. A few others was like two people we know. I think Lucas is one. Helen was one. Got hit while they're riding their bike.
Wow.
So there's things like that, people just pushing other people. And then, like, if you try to do something or call the police, they will say that you did wrong.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of Japanese people who know that the police will not believe foreigners.
This is why I avoid places with a lot of people. Like, As a general rule, people are shit. So I stay away from people. And when I'm like riding my bike, I'm all up in the streets taking every obscure route that has the least number of people. Like, I don't want to deal with it. That's emotionally taxing, mentally taxing. And I just try to avoid it at all costs.
Yeah. Look at this. This one said some random old dude yelling, "Old oi, Gaijin, I'll kill you," as I walk past the street.
It's like, it's so unprovoked, it's ridiculous. Like, you can't even be mad because you're just like, what?
Why?
It's, like, everyone's just stunned and they can't believe it's happening.
Right. It's just like, oh my God.
And I do worry that these problems will increase as the Olympics come up.
Yeah.
And then we're also going to have the World Expo in Osaka, which means there's going to be a big influx of tourists in a city that's not really built for tourists. There's not a lot of tourism facilities, or the infrastructure is not really made to handle like tourists. Like, when they get on commuter trains with their suitcases, the commuter trains barely support the commuters going to work. So add to that tourists, and it's a recipe for a lot of angry salarymen. It's mostly angry old salarymen that have attitudes. I've never had an issue with women as far as
I can remember. I think, and if it is women, it's usually the older generation. Because, like, that's what I saw in the video of the girl who got her stuff pushed away. But I think 80% of the time or 90% of the time, it's old men.
Yeah, older salarymen, people past their prime, probably looking to lash out.
As you can see, the most of the alcoholics in this country are older men. Mm-hmm. So it's like they might have a lot of stress from their work and just life in general. And then
people are definitely more likely to get violent when they're drunk.
Right. So I was also talking to somebody about the wall, and like, when they see a foreigner, it just disrupts their wa. And wa means what exactly in Japanese?
It's like peace.
It's like, it's peace.
Their tranquility
in Japanese culture. Their wa is mainly just Japanese. So if they see a foreign face or a face that doesn't include their wa, they immediately get upset.
I could believe that theory. Because it's so random sometimes. You'd be like, I'm just here. I'm just existing. You know, this world is big enough for all of us. Can you just leave me alone?
It is. It's kind of depressing. But I feel like if we just know our rights, especially when you are dealing with the police, then you can kind of like go through it a little bit better than being clueless.
Yeah, like, don't try to handle it the way you would back home, because it's just a different environment.
No.
They don't, like, if you yell, then they yell, and then everybody's yelling, and then you're still going to be the bad guy. Mm. The best way to end up the good guy is to maintain your composure.
Right.
Just stay as, like, super non-affected as you can.
Right.
Otherwise, you are going to be
exactly
the reason that everything is a problem.
Right. If I had known that, I would have probably not even said anything to the old man and just let it go.
Yeah.
But I think at that point in my life, I was just annoyed with Japan with a lot of things.
Yeah.
So I responded and I didn't have to.
Mm-hmm. If you're going to respond, you have to be ready to talk.
Yeah.
Which means you're going to have to do it in Japanese.
Yeah.
And you have to be cool about it.
Right.
You can't just be like, baga, baga. Because then
it doesn't
have to be like, I was minding my business.
Yeah.
He came over here.
Yeah.
He spat at me.
Yeah.
I don't know what his problem. You have to make the other person look like a complete idiot in order for you to be seen as not guilty. Right. Which is a lot of work for us. We're visitors to this country. Japanese is our second language. Maybe we don't know how to be super taming.
Also, when you're stressed, like, sometimes it just goes
really
out the
hard.
Window. No matter
it's
how
really
like advanced you are in the language, sometimes you just forget certain things because of the stress.
Yeah.
So I realize that now. But one thing I have to say about the two people that sent me videos is that when they took a video, they were calm and they took it. But just to be careful, don't like post it, because a lot of times they don't want that online.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do post it, make sure you blur their faces.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because of the law.
Yes.
Because if they find out that you posted it and find out where you are, they can like get the police on you.
Yeah.
So,
and if you're a resident here or working here,
that's
not going to help your case.
Not at all. So, yeah, just be careful with that.
Record audio if you can, actually.
Audio is better.
Yeah, audio. Yeah, definitely. Because that can be used. I mean, if you're going to use the video as evidence for the police, it's fine. But if you want to post something on the internet, it would be better to just use audio, because then you don't have to worry about, like, take a picture and then just have the audio play in the background. And that would be as effective, I think. I guess you could just freeze frame the video and just let the audio play in the background.
That's too. True. Yeah. Yeah, that would be best, because, like, you don't have to worry about the blurring of the action, because that's a lot of work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a lot of posts.
I will tell my friend that.
Yeah. I mean, if you want to definitely make people aware, because the more awareness we spread, the more likely the Japanese government is to do something about it. Otherwise, yeah. They're going to be like, I don't know what you're talking about. This doesn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah. That's best. So also, I will share links in the show notes about how to deal with some things, like when you encounter with the police and what you can do. It will mainly be about, not about, but like links for Americans and where they can go. But like maybe after you read some of it, you can get an idea of what to do if you're not American. And also to prevent. There's this link I have is rights can protect against fake cops. So this article was a while ago. It was like 2014, but it was basically how to deal with people who are asking you for your gaijin card, and they're not showing that they're police, because they could just steal your information and they maybe stalk you. I don't know. There's things like that. Yeah. And then also I heard that even if they're cops, they need like a reason to check. Do they?
Not really. I mean, from what I've seen, they can stop you. And they can demand to check your pockets. And if you say no, which you can say no, then they'll just get a warrant if they feel like they really want to check you.
But do you have to wait?
I mean, they'll follow you until the warrant comes.
Okay.
It's how it's done on TV, which I imagine is...
That's what I thought. Because, like, when I heard, it's like, you don't have to show your gaijin card. But I feel like if you don't show it, if you refuse, they're just going to bother you.
Yeah. So if you can, just do it. I've never been asked for my card, so I don't really know what that
situation is. Imani was, when she was, like, dressed up after a wedding. She was singing for a wedding, and then they stopped her at some station, and she's like, she took some video, and she's like, why am I being stopped? Why are you asking for my thing? Yeah.
And they're usually like, oh, illegal immigrants, we're looking for overstayers, and it's like, I mean, maybe it's a Tokyo thing, have you been stopped for your card?
Nope. The only time I got my card checked was when I was... This was, like, my first year in Japan when we were at a park just causing a lot of noise. It wasn't even me. It was the white kid. Boys that I was with. It wasn't me. It was not me. And they screamed racism. I'm like, y'all are just making too much fucking noise.
You are...
It said meiwaku. There's a sign that says Shizuka at night. Like, fuck. They were idiots. I'm not friends with them and at all now. Oh, they actually weren't my friends. One was a coworker and the other one was just his friend.
Precious.
Anyway, so there's that. So we'll have those links for you. And we're just hoping that the more we put out like the awareness, the better. We don't know if Japan will actually do anything, but...
Right. Protect yourself as best as you can.
Like the whole thing with Brianna... Miranda in Japan, like all that stuff, like being she got spat on.
Yeah, like, right. With the
everybody in the comments were like, "Oh, I want to throw some hands," and like, "You don't do that in Japan." Like, "Oh, I'll have some pepper spray." And I'm like, "No, that's illegal." anything that you do,
will be charged, and you will have to pay damages.
Exactly. Anything you do physically to someone, even if it's self-defense in Japan, means you will get in trouble. There was this girl that I know, she had some domestics, and she, I think, I don't know what she did exactly, but basically she defended herself, went to the cops, they say, we can't do anything because you hit him. Even though she was getting, it was her getting strangled.
Wow.
Yes. And she was like, defending herself, hit him to get him off, and she couldn't get help.
So what did she have to do?
I don't remember.
Oh my God.
Yeah, and it was just a little bit like a comment somewhere, so I'm not, you know, disclosing her name or anything, but it's just like when I read that story, I was like, are you kidding me?
Like, don't expect the cops to kind of vouch for you.
They don't really help women in general, so they're not going
to
help
foreign women. They don't do domestic violence disputes. They're like, you have to solve that. That's your problem. Bye.
Exactly.
So be careful. Just have a support group. Have someone you can turn to when you need to get away.
Right.
Because... the system ain't there.
Nah. So for those who listen to us who are in Japan and you're partying for the Christmas season or New Year's, be careful. Don't get into fights.
Please don't.
It's not worth it.
No, it's not.
At all.
You're the only one that's going to end up in pain or in trouble. So just walk away.
Yeah.
Or
I feel like recording it. Mm-hmm. Well, it's best. And like what you said, freeze frame, put the audio out there, let people know what's going on, and keep your composure. Like, you can be mad all you want, but the best revenge for them is...
Yeah, they want you to get mad. Yeah. They want you to get mad so you can react and they can charge you with something.
Yeah, because they want to call the cops on you. Don't. That guy who... Did you see the video? You watched the video.
Yeah, guy was
screaming at the top of his lungs.
People were trying to get him away from the guy, but...
They knew, like, he was the one that was in the wrong.
Yeah. Luckily, that guy had some people trying to help him out. But don't expect...
That to always happen.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes it's about to be just you.
All right. Well, we'll end that there.
Ooh, that was a dark...
It was very dark. Year,
last episode.
Just, you know, a warning. Caution.
Be safe during the new year.
Yeah. Anything else to add?
Try to have a happy new year.
Have a happy new year. And what is your plans for New Year's?
I'm going to the jika, which is Shota's family's house, and we're going to go to a temple.
Yeah?
Yeah, and I think that's it.
Well, I don't really have any travel plans because I did enough travel this month. I went to Philippines the first week, and then I went to Tokyo last week. So
all the money.
A bitch is broke.
All the money.
I don't have any money for any travel but to chill, relax.
Right.
New Year's.
I might hit a few parties. Before
which parties?
The end of Moon Tower party.
Oh, Moon Tower is finishing.
Yeah.
I'm so sad about that.
That was the spot. That's the late night spot when you're like too drunk to really get home yet. So you need to like sober up for a second.
Well, there's still LNL.
There's still LNL. There's still Moonshine. But I liked Moon Tower. I liked the paintings on the walls. They had a nice vibe.
Why is it closing?
They're tearing down the building. That's also, we need to talk about the gentrification of Amimura. I don't know if it's actually gentrifying, but they're definitely tearing down some of the more interesting establishments in favor of building
I'm
hotels.
A bit scared of, what is it, the video game place?
Space Station?
Yeah, they're about to close, or are they closing still?
Oh, crap.
And then on that street, too, they already shut down, like, a building, and they rebuild it up.
They're, like, everything's becoming, like, a
there
hotel.
There was this really cool, like, Brazilian burger place that building that was shut down, and, like you said, it's, like, a hotel now. And there's, like, this new hostel slash restaurant, like, two streets away, near closer to
there's
Ghost.
There's nothing in Amimura. I don't know why they're building all these hotels here. I don't get it.
Because I think people, like, young people like to hang around there, but it's really nothing.
They don't do nothing.
Like, they just stand around.
We just stand outside and drink. That's all we do in Amimura. Like, don't stay in Amimura. Like, it's not worth it.
It's also dirty.
It's a filthy-ass little corner of Osaka. That's just for hanging out with your friends outside.
Yeah, but they want to make it, I don't know, they want people to stay there so they can shop, hang out, and club all in one spot.
I guess.
But they first they need to get more good clubs. They don't have that. Even though there's like four.
Yeah, it's just okay.
It's just four or five. And then they have some live houses.
Yeah, they do have the live houses. Like, I mean, there's stuff to do there, but I feel like it's more for like locals.
It is, and it should be. Like, this whole hotel, hostel, building business is dampering everything there.
It's no bueno, man.
This is our rant section, I guess. I didn't name it in the beginning, but...
I worry for Osaka. Like, it's going to be a rough few years coming up with Bampaku, because they're not doing it in Bampaku Koen, which is...
What are they doing then?
They're going to do it out by Cosmo Square and like that area that's like has nothing. They're basically building a whole new expo center over there, I think is what I saw. So that means everybody's going to be in the city.
What year is that?
2025.
I won't be here.
I won't be here either, honestly.
Just to let all y'all know.
This is not a forever thing.
Kurlyinkansai is numbered.
It has an expiration date.
It has an expiration date. We don't know when that expiration date is, per se. But when we figure that out, we will let you know. Because
we'll have a countdown party.
Alyse and I are tired of the shits.
Yeah, I'm just ready for like a quiet... outskirts life in a country that gives a shit about me sometimes.
Right.
You know? I'm just tired of having to fight for everything or having to argue about everything. Like, common sense things. Like, maybe women should be allowed to, like, have a full-time job and also be able to take care of their kids. I don't know. That sounds like a good idea to me. I don't know why we have to fight about this. But, you know, people are like, well, women traditionally. It's
like the culture I'm like that yeah, only was, like 100 yeah, years old.
Yeah.
Sure. Traditional. Like
Japanese culture, you know, women just do.
No. No.
There are some parts of Japanese culture that need to die.
Yes.
Let it die.
Like the old people.
Oh my God. old people are fine. Not all old people.
Not all old people.
Hashtag not all old people. I know some really cool old people.
I do too. I'm not saying
it's mostly the sexist, racist guys that should probably.
The ones that attack foreigners.
They should be delegated to like one of those old World War II islands that have cats on it or something. I don't know.
Or bunnies and foxes and stuff.
Yeah, they should live over there.
What they really need is some recreational plants.
That's 50 years.
The smoke. What they really need, they don't need alcohol. They need some plants to help them cope.
You see how badly people handle alcohol here?
Yeah, they would.
Can you imagine how badly they would handle any other recreational substance?
Yeah.
They would lose their minds.
Yeah. So never mind.
This is not a
what they really need is like proper
therapy.
Yeah. That's what I was going to say. Thank you.
They need a hug and they need someone
they
to
need
talk
skinship
to.
And yeah, people to talk to.
I think that's what everybody needs though.
And they need to get rid of the tatemae.
We all need a hug and someone to talk to. We should share it with all of
sharing
the arts archipelago.
Yes. Let's do that. So on a happier note, we are still here. I'm continuing my sentence. On a happier note, we are still here until we are not.
I guess that's a happy note.
That is a happy note.
It's happier than the last note.
Yeah. We don't know when we're finishing this podcast. We are still going on. And yeah.
Maybe we'll go on from different parts of the world and we'll be Kurly in other parts of the world.
Yeah, we might do another podcast elsewhere.
That would be cool.
And name it something else.
That could be cool.
That would be.
Like, think about the future.
Yeah. It's positive.
Everybody should think
about it. It's bright. The future is bright.
Myriad.
But anyway, I just wanted to also say that, yes, I've enjoyed my time in Japan.
It's been cool.
I'm still enjoying a good amount of my time here because I've made a little community that is making me sane. That's keeping me sane, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
So I think with that, if you can find a good circle of friends a good group, then you can survive the shitty parts of Japan because Japan is not a utopia.
No.
At all. There's cool parts, but it's not a utopia.
You got to make the world a better place.
Right. That sounds like a Michael Jackson song.
Oh, for you and for me. Feel the world. Make it a better place.
You know I don't know the lyrics.
Wow.
I wanted to sing it. I'm taking your Jackson card. I didn't have a card for Jackson.
Well, I'm going to take it anyway.
Anyway, I know the song. I'm the one that mentioned it. I just didn't know the lyrics.
Disappointed.
Well, we're going to end the episode there on the singing notes because that's more right. We would like to continue the conversation in the comments on YouTube, SoundCloud, and Twitter. Our Twitter is Kurlyinkansai with a K.
Kurlyinkansai.
And yeah. Please also tweet us personally. Mine is Yana_YZ, and you are?
I changed it, actually.
Mm.
Now it's @NanaIroMiso, same as Instagram, Nana as in 7, Iro as in color, and Miso as in miso soup.
And if you want to check out like my comments, the post that I had about asking people their situation or their encounters with Japanese being aggressive to them, you can check there on my personal Twitter. And our website is www.kurlyinkansai.com. And if you'd like to donate and help this podcast stay long as possible until we have to leave, we have a site called ko-fi.com/kurlyinkansai.
Sip, sip.
Coffee with a ko-fi.com/kurlyinkansai. So please check that out. And yeah, we'll get back to you when we can. So we'll see you next time. Bye. A couple of queens who like to slay and have fun.